I hope you guys are ready for this. The Memphis Grizzlies, we're about to talk about them, but we're not going to talk about the guys you think we're going to talk about. We're actually going to talk about Robert Pera and their coach, Mr. Joerger. So here's the story. Owner Pera got a controlling interest in the team. He's a billionaire from Silicon Valley, and he challenged Tony Allen to a game of one-on-one. Tony Allen accepted the challenge and later reneged on the challenge. That did not make the owner happy. So the owner still wanted to go through, of course. Coach Joerger said that's not going to happen, and that turned Pera on Joerger. So Pera tried to fire Joerger, and this is about six games into the season. And he had to be talked down off that cliff just to say, that's going to make us look really like a rinky-dink organization. Then he goes challenges Michael Jordan to a game of one-on-one, saying he's the best basketball-playing owner in the NBA. And then he allows his head coach, who's currently the head coach, to go audition for another job in Minnesota. This is the strangest scene out of any NBA movie you've ever seen. What would you do if you were a Memphis Grizzlies fan, or what can be done? Like, they're in a tough position because their owner's a lunatic. I'm going to go out in there and say it.
Well, I mean, I'd still rather have this guy as the owner than Donald Sterling. So
he's not the worst.
But he's obviously one in this kind of weirdo club of guys. I don't know this guy, Pera. I know so little about him, but this story is just so bizarre. Challenging players and other owners.
Challenging Tony Allen.
It's so weird, and it just reeks of a guy who found his way into this club of NBA owners, and he doesn't give a about winning games. His ego is tripping on being involved in it, and I think somebody should tell him to just go away back into the background.
Take your money back.
Be a good owner. Let the team trust the basketball people to run the team, and you go back there and enjoy your investment.
Now, the reason I brought this story up is because I want to talk about contrasting styles and ownership. We never really talk about owners, but I think there's really two schools. There's, you know, the out there Mark Cuban style and the behind the scenes father Jerry Buss style. Which style do you guys prefer? I'll start with you. Like, I'm a big Jerry Buss fan, I think you know.
Newsflash.
Showtime.
But I'm of the sit back, let the basketball people do what they do, and you just worry about making sure there's money in the bank. That's why you're the owner. You're the bank. Yeah. And that's what they're... I mean, it works for Mark Cuban because everybody in Dallas, that's how Mark Cuban is, even when he's doing his business stuff outside of the NBA. But as an owner, it's a lot easier to sit back and watch and make the big decisions when it comes down to signing the checks. That's what they should be doing and just worrying about that.
Speaking of sitting back and watch, Adrian, what is your perspective on this one?
I'm a fan of the old school. I'm a Jerry West guy. I grew up being a diehard Yankee fan. George Steinbrenner, Jerry West, to me, is kind of like the same thing. Just lay back, put a winning team on the court, on the field, whatever, and just let your guys be your guys. What Mark Cuban does, I don't mind it too much. He did win a championship doing it that way, so you can't knock him for being like a terrible owner.
He's not a terrible owner.
Right, so I'm just saying, no one cannot say that because he puts Dirk in a position to win.
Yes.
But I'm a guy of the old school, Jerry West, the way he does. The way Jim Buss is doing is just...
Oh, no.
They got to get Genie in there. That's what I think.
I don't like Jim Buss. I like Jerry Buss. That's my stance, of course. I'm a Jerry Buss guy. Now, another thing I wanted to talk about was... The reason I brought this up was because, Tannenbaum, Laiwiki, Ujiri. This is the new leadership group for the Toronto Raptors, and we see the success this year, and it's kind of when these three guys, this new trinity, has come in place. And do you guys believe in the trickle-down effect from ownership because Memphis is struggling, and now we see Toronto kind of having a good run underneath great leadership?
Well, the Raptors certainly responded this season, and I think in Masai, they trust. You know, you saw the personal relationships between the players and the general manager, and it just seemed to be magic. And you have the feeling, you have the sense that it's going to continue that way moving into next season and beyond.
All right. Well, hey, listen, it's time for me to do the parting shot, but I want to thank all you guys for coming out. Shouts out to the NBL. It's about time Canada had its own basketball league. I'm proud of all you guys for your careers, and I'm proud of the league for putting the game on the map out here. It's time for the parting shot, and shouts out to all my Pinoy brethren. I'm from Scarborough. I'm from the Danforth. You know I got my Filipinos, and they got my backup. But I got to talk about one thing. Andre Blatch is now a member of your basketball team. Andre Blatch has never been to the Philippines. He has no Filipino relatives. I'm sure he probably has a Filipino friend. And Andre Bash wasn't even the only guy they approached. Looks like the Philippines are trying to make a huge push in international basketball. Props to you. Your first big win is Andre Blatch. Enjoy that, and the best of luck, of course, moving forward. This has been The Hangout. Thank you for watching. Make sure to like us on Facebook, /the NBA Hangout. Follow us on YouTube. I'm Mickey Lagerstein. That does it for our show, man. Thanks for watching. Watch next week. Peace.